I will say in Chinese words, and then I will say it in English. Okay? 好，各位請坐啊。我哋今晚咧好開心，請到埃及嘅主教神父同埋一批教友啊，咁啊嚟到咧同我哋分享啦，關於埃及嘅教會。你記得啦，埃及教會邊個開教噶？冇人答我呢班人啦，耶穌嘛，佢著草嘅時候去咗噶嘛。好啦，唔好嘥時間，咁我哋準備啦，好嘛 ？Metropolitan Joseph， yeah， His Eminence， yeah， okay， Bishop Prevey and all the priests， welcome to our parish， it's the Catholic parish。However, we are the same church in Christ. Okay? And so welcome and share your tradition, your precious faith to us all. And even you bring a group of brothers and sisters from Egypt. You know, in Hong Kong, we seldom see Egyptian faces. Now we see so many handsome and beautiful Egyptian faces. We thank God and thank for your coming.We welcome you again. And so, the following hours are yours. And so, you may explain to us the grace of the Lord, how the Christianity developed in Egypt. You are our brother church. And so, Metropolitan, help us and pray for us.The microphone is for you now.
들으셨나요?
Okay. Yes. How many bigger time I... 시
간? 야,없어라.
You need this one?
Yes, please.
Okay.For the bishop, you need another mic?
One is one.
Oh, the violin is one. Okay. Hold on, I have earnest to go with it. But we need to get a little bit of a sing song now. So my people, I can't. You see, we can act. I'm a sing song. I can't get a song.
Good evening. We are very happy to be with you today. We are from the Coptic Church of Egypt. We are Coptic Orthodox, and Coptic means Egyptians, and Orthodox is our faith. We are volunteers in the service that we are doing, and we have traveled all of this way from Egypt to here to spread the word of God and to have the honor to be with you tonight. We will be starting today by sharing with you some of our hymns that we use in our blessings and in our prayers in our church. The first thing that we'll be sharing with you is called Through the Intercessions of the Theotokos, Saint Mary. O Lord, grant us the forgiveness of our sins. We worship you, O Christ, with your good Father and the Holy Spirit, for you have come and saved us, a mercy of peace, a sacrifice of praise. But we will not be chanting this in English. We'll be actually chanting this in Coptic, and Coptic is the ancient language that ancient Egypt used to speak with, and this is part of a tradition that lasted for more than 2,000 years till now. So,Hope you enjoy what will be presented to you. He ten beres veyen tetise otokos es oab mare Choi sari ehmot non imbiko evolen tene novi Teno oste moko becherestos Nem bekioten agasos Nem beb nevma es oab Je akton kaxoti emon
Eleos Irinis Siseia Eos.
The second thing that we'll be sharing with you is a hymn that we use in different prayers, and this one will be in English, and it's called Father God.
Father God, I wonder how I manage to exist without the knowledge of your parenthood and your loving care. Now I am your son, I am adopted in your family, and I can never be alone. 'Cause Father God, you're there beside me.
I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises forevermore. I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises forevermore.
Father God, I wonder how I manage to exist without the knowledge of your parenthood and your loving care. Now I am your son, I am adopted in your family, and I can never be alone, 'cause Father God, you're there beside me.
I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises forevermore. I will sing your praises, I will sing your praises forevermore.
Third and final, we go back again to the Coptic language, and when we conclude any prayer, we say Amen. So Amen is truth, and we have a very popular hymn that we used to pray in every Mass that starts with Amen, Amen, Amen. It says in English, your death, O Lord, we proclaim, your holy resurrection and ascension into the heaven, we confess, we praise you, we bless you, we thank you, O Lord, and we entreat you, our God. So it basically summarizes all of our faith. Now let's hear it together. We'll sing it in Coptic.
Amen, 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 ton sana ton so kiri, katange. So anastasi ketin analim epsin so entis oranis se homologomin se enome se eflogomin se
Now, when we visit our different countries, one of the biggest barriers that we have is the language. So sometimes we are in a country that they cannot understand our language, or we cannot speak in English. However, we still try to share our faith and what is the philosophy of Christianity in general. So how can we surpass and transcend beyond the language barriers? So we thought about art, and we thought about how we can do some sort of like simple acts that can describe our faith in a way that can be understood universally, regardless of any language and regardless of the place or the culture or any different thing that can stop us. So we created something that we call silent drama. And in these silent dramas, we do some acts where we deliver a story. The story is without anyone speaking, so that it can deliver what is the idea. So we are also happy to share with you tonight one of our versions of those silent dramas, and hopefully you'll enjoy the show.
Thank you. was looking for a breath of life, a little touch of heavenly light. But all the choirs in my head said,
So that was intense. This lady was living her life in very common way and was very normal in the beginning. But after a while, the money and the fame and alcohol just was around her, attracting her like super magnets. But she didn't feel it in the beginning. She just enjoyed her life like normal person in the street. After a while, this joy and this happiness that turned into ties, turned into super magnets, as I said, and started to track her and tie her and control her. Control her. She was going through all the temptations right and left. But deep inside her, she was feeling like there is more than that in the life. There's more than that in the back end. And then Jesus arrived. Jesus has been the light to her. He just break the ties, but didn't judge her. He didn't blame her for what she did. He just break the ties and take it for her. And from his salvation and through his cross, and after that, his resurrection, he provided her his grace to live. And each one of us is like her. We have the grace. We have the grace of Jesus. We can go through our lives and choose to have the grace of Jesus that she had, or get the temptation or the ties and super magnets we got from this temptation. So this is a story of not this lady only. It's the story of all of us. And thank you for watching.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Amen. I'm happy to be with you tonight in this blessed church, with this blessed congregation. And from my heart, I like to thank Reverend Father Thomas for his very warm welcome to our congregation here and to share with you this night in which actually we will speak together about Coptic Church history, tradition, faith, where actually the Coptic Church comes between all the denominations of the world. And I like to start by asking the question, have you ever visited the Holy Land? Maybe many of you visited the Holy Land, and it is called the Holy Land because our Lord Jesus Christ with the Blessed Virgin, Saint Mary, and Saint Joseph lived there, and the Lord grew up there until his ascension to the heaven. But I like to ask another question. Is there any other place called the Holy Land? If the Holy Land is called the Holy Land, it became holy just because the Lord Jesus Christ, then actually we know from the Gospel of St. Matthew that the Holy Land, His Holy Family blessed Egypt and actually stayed in Egypt for 3 years and 6 months. So the answer is yes. Egypt also is a holy land because it is the only country beside Jerusalem that's blessed with the presence of the Holy Family for 3 years and 6 months. Egypt was visited by the Lord Jesus Christ, Saint Mary, and Saint Joseph. They stayed there almost 40 months, and we boast that Egypt is the only country other than Jerusalem that was blessed by the Lord Jesus Christ. And as a child, you know, if there is a family from Egypt here in Hong Kong, so the children, when they start to grow, they will catch the language of the country. So I'm sure the children who grew up here start to speak Chinese. In the same way, as a child, the Lord Jesus Christ start to speak in Egypt, meaning he spoke definitely some words from the Coptic language. And the Coptic language is the language of the Egyptian at that time. It is a very recent form of the hieroglyphic language, which is the language of the Pharaoh. And here there is a beautiful icon, how the Holy Family in a boat in the Nile River. And there is an angel who is protecting the family during their journey from Jerusalem to Egypt. And Egypt has a very rich history of Christianity, 2,000 years of ancient Christianity. Also, Egypt contributed a lot to the Christianity to the whole world, as we will explain. And you know, Egypt, actually, from the north, there is a Mediterranean Sea, and from the east, there is the Red Sea. And our church is called the Coptic Orthodox Church. And we wonder what the word Coptic means. What the word Coptic means. Actually, the word Coptic is derived from Pharaonic words, he kapta. Ha kapta, ha means house, ka means god, ta is one of the ancient Egyptian gods. Ha kapta. And in Greek, ha kapta became Egyptos. And if you see Egyptos, Egypt, Copt. So if you eliminate the E from the beginning and you replace the G with C, it will be Copt. So actually, the word Coptic means Egyptian. So when we say you are Coptic Orthodox Church, means the Egyptian Orthodox Church. But now actually, the word Coptic means the Christian in Egypt. Although literally it means Egyptian, so I can say Coptic Muslims, Coptic Christian, in the meaning of the word. But now when you say I am Coptic, means you are Christian. If you say I am Coptic, means you are Christian. So Coptic Orthodox Church means the Egyptian Orthodox Church. Who are the Copts? Copts are the descendant of Pharaohs. If you read in Genesis chapter 10, you will find the genealogy. Noah has three children, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. And sons were born to them after the flood. Then the sons of Ham were Cush. Cush went to Ethiopia. And until now, Ethiopia is called the land of Cush. Mizraim, Put, and Canaan. Mizraim actually is the father of all the Egyptians. That's why another name for Egypt, Misr. Misr from the word Mizraim. And Mizraim begot Lodim, Anamim, Lehabim, Naphtuhim, and from also he has Kafturim, as we read in Genesis 10, verse 13. So Mizraim, that is the origin of the word Misr, and Kafturim, one of the children of Mizraim, I wrote it here in red, Kafturim. From the word Kafturim also the word Kapt came, Kafturim, Kapt. So that is the origin of the word Misr and Kapt. Who started actually the Coptic Orthodox Church? After the Great Commission, before the ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, he told them, go preach the gospel to the whole world and baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So when the Lord, after the descent of the Holy Spirit on Pentecost, he sent all the disciples to the whole world, one of them, Saint Mark, who is the author of the second gospel, Mark, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So Saint Mark actually went to Egypt and stayed in Egypt from around 46 AD to 48 AD. And he preached Christianity there. And also Saint Mark was martyred on the eve of resurrection. The pagan actually took him from the church in the eve of resurrection feast in the year 68 AD, and they dragged him in the streets of Alexandria. They dragged him in the streets of Alexandria. And this is the icon of Saint Mark. He's holding a book that is the Gospel of Saint Mark. And as you know, there is a lion. Usually you find lion next to the icon of Saint Mark. We have the four incorporeal creatures, the lion, the calf, the eagle, and the lion. So they represent, the man, face of man. This represent the four evangelists. The face of man represent Saint Matthew, because he spoke about Son of Man, Jesus Christ, Son of Man. Saint Mark in his gospel spoke about the Lord Jesus Christ, the King. That's why the lion represent Jesus Christ, the King, the lion who came from the tribe of Judah. Saint Luke spoke about our Lord Jesus Christ, the Redeemer, who offered himself as a sacrifice. So the calf represent the Gospel of St. Luke. And St. John spoke about Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the divinity of Christ. So the eagle represents the Gospel of St. John. So that's why we find a lion. Also, in the chapter 1, we hear the voice of one crying in the wilderness. And the voice of the who is crying in the wilderness? Our Lord Jesus Christ. He's crying in the wilderness of this world to repent, because the kingdom of God is at hand. And the voice here represents St. John the Baptist, who came to prepare the way for the ministry of our Lord Jesus Christ. And when St. Mark went to Egypt, he ordained a bishop, St. Enianus, deacons and priests. And the first bishop was named Enianus. And if St. Mark is considered the first patriarch in the Coptic Orthodox Church, so St. Enianus is the second patriarch after the martyrdom of St. Mark. And this icon actually has St. Mark actually washing the feet of St. Enianus. As the Lord told us, he said to the disciples, "As I washed your feet, go and wash the feet of one another." It's a beautiful icon in which actually we can see how St. Mark literally is following the advice and the commandment of our Lord Jesus Christ to wash the feet of one another. And behind St. Mark, you can see a lion and also a scroll representing the Gospel of St. Mark. And there are shoes around St. Enianus because he was a shoemaker. And there is a nice story in the Coptic tradition. The Lord Jesus Christ asked the disciples before going to preach, he told them, don't carry two tunics, don't carry shoes with you, don't carry silver, don't carry gold, nothing. So St. Mark followed the instruction of our Lord Jesus Christ. And actually, after the long trip from Jerusalem to Egypt, his shoes were torn, and he wanted actually to repair the shoes. So he found Enianus, who was actually working as a shoemaker. And Enianus, as you see in the icon, he's repairing the shoe of St. Mark. And he wounded himself. Then he said in Greek, Eiotheo, means the one God. So when St. Mark heard these words, he told him, do you know God? And he started preaching Christ to him. What's beautiful about this story, if St. Mark took another shoes with him, violating the instruction of the Lord Jesus Christ, he wouldn't need to go to Enianus. And Enianus actually became the first patriarch after St. Mark, and also his house is the first church in Egypt. So just believing and trusting the words of the Lord Jesus Christ and following them opens the door in Egypt to accept Christianity. And while before the lecture, while we were drinking coffee with Father Thomas, he spoke about the apostolic succession and the laying of hands. And we say the Coptic Church is an apostolic church because St. Mark was actually ordained by the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And St. Mark ordained Enianus and so on. So there is a series of 118 patriarchs. If number one is St. Mark, then His Holiness Pope Tawadros on my left, on your right, that's patriarch number 118. And His Holiness Pope Shenouda of the Blessed Memory, he is number 117. And we have uninterrupted change from the patriarch, starting by St. Mark, and now His Holiness Pope Tawadros, Pope number 118. And actually, when you study the history of ancient Egypt, you can see how God prepared Egyptians before even the visit of St. Mark to accept Christianity. So Egyptians in general are very spiritual. If you study the life of the pharaohs, the pyramids, for example, pyramids are what? Are actually tombs. And because they believed in life after death, they actually built this huge tomb because they believed in life after death. They believed in one god, Akhenaton, actually wrote many poems about the one god. So although they were pagan, pagan means worshiping idols, they believed in eternity and heavenly things. They believed in Trinity. They have Isis, Osiris, and Horus. And I am sure because of the trade and people traveling from like Jerusalem, Israel, to Egypt, and from Egypt to Jerusalem, so some doctrines were shared, but the Egyptian shaped it in their own understanding. And this was God's way to prepare the Egyptians to believe in the gospel of Christ and believe in the Holy Trinity and believe in the salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ. And they have actually a symbol on your right hand. This symbol is called Ankh. And Ankh in Coptic language means life. And this symbol is very similar to what? To the cross. Because through the cross of Jesus Christ, we actually moved from death to life. We were under the sentence of death, but we moved to life through his cross. So again, this Ankh is actually God, one way of God's preparing the Egyptian to accept the salvation of our Lord Jesus Christ. And I said, the huge pyramid with embalming of the dead bodies, this because they believed in eternal life. And I'm sure the story of the war between Archangel Michael and the devil regarding the body of Moses, actually somehow this story was shared with the Egyptians, because the Egyptians lived 400 years, sorry, the Israelites lived 400 years in Egypt, and Moses actually was born there until the Exodus from Egypt. So there is an icon, that's the icon of Archangel Michael, in which he is defeating Satan, but there is, in the Egyptian tradition, Horus' battle was set between him, between Horus, and Seth, which reminds us between the war between Archangel Michael and the devil. So, and even you can see the similarity between the two pictures. And again, God is preparing the mind of the Egyptian to receive Christianity. Therefore, before hearing about the Lord Jesus Christ, Egyptians were able, through meditation, reflection upon and searching for God, and also the trade and exchanging doctrines between them and Israel. So they were actually to reach some revelations about God. So this helped St. Mark when he came and preached Christianity in Egypt, helped them to accept Christianity. And now we hear many about many denominations. Even in the Orthodox Church, Coptic Orthodox Church, Ethiopian Orthodox Church, Russian Orthodox Church, Greek Orthodox Church, and we have the Catholic, have many Protestant denominations. So where the Coptic Orthodox Church falls among all these denominations? So I like to give you some historical background to understand where the Coptic Church falls among all these different denominations. As we know, the first split that happened in the Christian history was in the Council of Chalcedon, year 451. So until year 451, all Christians were considered one church in communion with each other, East and West. And there was no denomination until this time. But there were five sees. Sees means like centers for Christianity. In the middle Jerusalem, because Christianity started from Jerusalem, and from Jerusalem it spread to Antioch. And by the way, the believers were called the first Christian in Antioch, as we read in the book of Acts. And spread to Alexandria, when St. Mark went to Alexandria, spread to Rome, when St. Paul and St. Peter went to Rome, and to Ephesus, Asia Minor, where St. John, the beloved, the theologian, actually lived there. And as I just said, Antioch was the first place where the followers of Christ were called Christians, as we read, because they had many titles like disciples. So the people will say, these disciples of whom? Disciples of Christ. So it's better just to call them Christian. It will be easy instead of just saying we are the disciples of Christ. And the first country used the word, the term Christian was Antioch, and from Antioch it spread to the whole world. And Asia Minor was not one of the very old sees. The very old sees are four, actually, Jerusalem, Antioch, Alexandria, and Rome. But when King Constantine became emperor, he made Christianity the official religion of his empire. And he wanted to build a new Rome in Asia Minor. And he called it Constantinople. And he said Constantinople is a sister country to Rome. And according to the tradition of the Church of Rome, that Peter founded Christianity in Rome, that's why he said Constantinople is the see of St. Andrew. Because Andrew and Peter are sisters. Andrew and Peter are brothers. So if Peter founded Rome, then Constantinople, which is a sister church to Rome, founded by Andrew. That's why it's called the See of St. Andrew. And he called it Constantinople. It's Turkey now. And it became one of the sees during the time of the ecumenical councils. So by the middle of the 5th century, we have five sees: Rome, Constantinople or Asia Minor, Antioch, Jerusalem, and Alexandria. All these churches attended the first three ecumenical councils. The Council of Nicaea, 325, and by the way, next year, God willing, we'll celebrate 1700 years, the anniversary of the Ecumenical Council of Nicaea, from 325 to 2025, 1700 years. And the Council of Constantinople at 381, and Council of Ephesus at 431. The first split, it happened in year 451, as I said, in the Council of Chalcedon. And it was about the nature of Christ. And it is a big issue. How we read the Council of Chalcedon? Some people say it is theological. Some people say it's political. Some people say it's misunderstanding of terminology. But when actually you read the Tome of Leo and you read the original documents of the Council of Chalcedon, you will find actually it is both theological and political. It is both theological and political. So several churches did not agree on Leo's tomb, which speak about two natures, diophyses, in the Lord Jesus Christ. So those churches who accepted the tomb of Leo, so these churches also accepted the canons of the Council of Chalcedon, diophyses, or diophysite churches. But so now we have a group believed in the two natures and in the Council of Chalcedon. So we call them the Chalcedonian Christian. And another group who did not accept the teaching of the Council of Chalcedon, so they are the non-Chalcedonian. A non-Chalcedonian, they believed in meiophyses. Meiophyses. Meia means one from two natures. Sometimes in some books, actually, books of history, they accuse the Oriental churches, including the Coptic Church, as monophysite. We are not monophysite. Mono means single, single nature. But we are meia. Meiophysite means one from two, because we believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is perfect man and perfect the divine. And these two natures united together without mingling, without confusion, and without alteration. So the Coptic Orthodox Church did not accept the Council of Chalcedon. And we follow the teaching of Saint Cyril of Alexandria, who actually was one of the greatest theologians. And Saint Cyril of Alexandria, in Greek, he said, Meia physis to Theo logo Caesar Comini. Means Meia, as I told you, one from two, one nature of the Word of God incarnate. So that is the faith, that's what we believe regarding the nature of Jesus Christ. We believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is a perfect human and a perfect divine. And these two natures were united together in a very unique way, in a very mystical way, without mingling, without confusion, and without alteration. So that is the first split happened in the middle of the 5th century, left the Christian into two groups, Chalcedonian and non-Chalcedonian. Then the second split, it happened among the Chalcedonians. And in the books of history, this split is referred to as the Great Schism between East and West. And it happened in year 1054, East and West Schism. And this was about the Filioque, which is the procession of the Holy Spirit. In the Nicene Creed, it is stated that we believe in the Holy Spirit who proceeds from the Father, as we read in John chapter 15, verse 26. But the Church of Rome added the word Filioque in Latin, and Filioque means and the Son, which means the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. Constantinople in the East rejected this term, and a split happened among Chalcedonian churches. Actually, before we start this lecture, Father Thomas told us we need actually to, at the end of this meeting, to pray the creed together. And when we pray it with the Orthodox, we don't say the word Filioque, which actually is the reason of the second schism. And I thank him for this. And God willing, after we finish, we recite the creed together without mentioning the word Filioque. Thank you, Father Thomas, for asking or recommending to pray the creed together. So by year 1054, we have three groups. The first group, the non-Chalcedonian church. They believe in meiophyses and the procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father only. The second group, Eastern Chalcedonian churches. They believe in diophyses, two natures, and the procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father only. And the Western Chalcedonian churches believe in diophyses, two natures, and procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father and the Son. To make it easy, instead of saying non-Chalcedonian churches, and people were confused, who are the non-Chalcedonian or Eastern Chalcedonian churches? That's why each group has a name to make it easy. So the non-Chalcedonian churches are called Oriental Orthodox churches. Oriental Orthodox churches. And the Eastern Chalcedonian churches, Eastern Orthodox churches. And the Western Chalcedonian churches is the Roman Catholic Church. So now, when we say Roman Catholic, means two natures, procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father and the Son. Eastern Orthodox, two natures, procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father only. Oriental Orthodox churches, meiphesis, one nature from two, one from two, and procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father only. The third split. Third split happened in the Roman Catholic Church around the 16th century. A Catholic monk from Germany, his name Martin Luther, different from Martin Luther King, wanted actually to reform the Catholic Church. And therefore he split from the Catholic Church and protested. And the word protested is the origin of the word Protestant. Protested many practices done by it. And Martin Luther actually started the Lutheran Church. And that is the seed of the Protestant, because Protestant protesting. And after Luther, they called for liberal theology. What does mean liberal theology? Interpret the Bible, just read it and interpret as you want. Don't go to the roots. Don't go to early church fathers. As you want, just interpret the Bible. That's why many other denominations start to be formed after this. I just heard recently, now there are maybe more than 30,000 different Protestant denominations. That's a very huge number. Although all of us are using the same book, the same Bible, the same text. The fourth split happened also in the Roman Catholic Church in year 1531. King Henry VIII wanted actually to divorce his wife, but the Catholic Church did not approve it because there is no divorce in the Catholic, until now. They allow annulment, but there is no divorce in the Catholic Church. So he split from the Catholic Church and divorced his wife, and he appointed himself as the head of the church. And this is actually the Anglican Church, which is the Church of England. And until now, like King Charles now is the head of the church, not the Archbishop of Canterbury. The head of the church is King Charles, and before him was Queen Elizabeth. So the Anglican Church is the Church of England. But when the Anglican actually moved to America, they cannot call them Anglican, because Anglican means England. So they called themselves the Episcopal Church. So the Episcopal Church in America actually is the Anglican Church who immigrated to America. So we are Oriental Orthodox Church. We believe in meiphesis, one nature from two. And we believe also in procession of the Holy Spirit from the Father only. How many Oriental Orthodox churches? There are six Oriental Orthodox churches. The Coptic Orthodox Church, Eritrean Orthodox Church, Ethiopian Orthodox Church, Syrian Orthodox Church, Indian Orthodox Church, and Armenian Orthodox Church. So these six churches are one family who are in communion with each other. The Eastern Orthodox Church are almost 16 different churches whose names are based on the country. It's in test here. So like Greek from Greece, Russian from Russia, Romanian from Romania, Serbian from Serbia, and so on. So there are 16 different churches based on the country. So this diagram actually summarizes what I said. The first split in the Council of Chalcedon, 451. Now they split into two groups, non-Chalcedonian, the Oriental Orthodox Church, and Chalcedonian, who believe in two natures. Then another split among the Chalcedonian Church became Eastern Orthodox Church, rejected Filioque, and Roman Catholic Church added Filioque. Then another split happened in the Roman Orthodox Church. Now we have the Lutheran Church and the Anglican Church. And then from the Lutheran Church, now many, many the other denominations like Baptist, Methodist, Church of Christ, non-denominational, universal Unitarian. So all these churches. And there is a dialogue happening between the two Orthodox families, the Oriental and the Eastern. This dialogue started in 1964, but became serious toward the end of the 80s. And in 1989, a very important document was signed between the theologian of the Eastern Orthodox Church and the Oriental Orthodox Church. This statement is about the nature of Christ. And it's called the agreed statement between Eastern Orthodox Church and the Oriental Orthodox Church. Actually, if you look at the internet, you can find the exact document, the agreed statement between Eastern and Oriental Orthodox Church. And simply, if I want to summarize it, it states that we believe that the Lord Jesus Christ is a perfect human, perfect divine. The two natures are united together without mingling, without confusion, and without alteration. And later on, another dialogue happened with the Catholic Church about the nature of Christ. And also the representative from the Catholic Church and the Orthodox Church signed the same agreed statement that we believe that Jesus Christ is perfect human, perfectly divine, the two natures united together without confusion, without alteration, and without mingling. The last point I like to discuss, the contribution of the Coptic Orthodox Church to the whole world. There are many things, actually, but I will focus on four contributions very unique to the Coptic Church. The first contribution is monasticism. The Coptic Orthodox Church takes pride that the first monk and the father of all monks in the whole world is a Coptic Egyptian man from Upper Egypt, born in a province called Bani Suif, and he is Saint Anthony the Great. And this is the icon of Saint Anthony the Great. And in his hand, he's holding a verse from the scripture. In the story of Saint Anthony, he entered the church on one Sunday, and he heard the deacon or the priest reading the gospel, saying the word of the Lord Jesus Christ to the rich man, if you want to be perfect, go sell all what you have, give it to the poor, come follow me. And Saint Anthony literally did this. He actually inherited from his parent 300 acres of very good land. So he was actually one of the very rich people. He sold the 300 acre, distributed the money to the poor, and he went to lived in the desert. And he established actually a monasticism. And there are three forms of monasticism. The first form, we call it hermetic monasticism. It's complete isolation, like the Saint Paul, the first hermit. And that is the icon of Saint Paul. And God actually used to send a raven to him with half loaf of bread every day. And Saint Anthony, when God told him about Saint Paul, and he went and visited him, on that day, the raven actually brought him a full loaf of bread to be shared with Saint Anthony. So the hermits are people who live in complete isolation, complete seclusion. For many years, they don't see any person. The second type is the synoptic monasticism, founded by Saint Bakum in Upper Egypt. And monks used to live like in a dorm together. And they lived in communion. And the monastery, actually, like a village, having an abbot and rules. Saint Bacon was a soldier in the army. So actually, he took actually the structure of the army and structured the monastery in the same way. The two styles are not practical for all of us, to live in complete seclusion or to live in communion, sharing the same room and the same dorm the rest of your life, are not comfortable to all of us. That's why a third form of monasticism, and these three forms actually started in Egypt also, which is semi-hermetic monasticism, like actually our monasteries right now. So it keeps the balance between solitary and communal lives. So we live together in the same place, in the same monastery, but each monk has his own separate cell. We gather together, we commune together for prayer, for divine liturgy, for spiritual meetings, but each one has his own cell, his own life. That's why it survived for 16th century from the time of Saint Anthony, because it is kept the balance between solitary life, you have your own cell, and also living in a community, because our souls are relational souls. We grow in relationship. And this some pictures of Saint Anthony Monastery in the Red Sea and Saint Paul Monastery. On the left hand, it's called Saint Mary and Saint John Kama Monastery, famous as El Surian Monastery. And this monastery actually is where I became a monk. On your left side, that is a picture of El Surian Monastery. Yeah, it's a big picture here. Also, there is a verse in Isaiah 19:19. It says, in that day, there will be an altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt, and a pillar of the Lord at its border. If you draw a line from the northeast part of Egypt to the most southern part of Egypt, and from the east to the west, so these two lines will meet at the center of Egypt. Exactly at the center of Egypt, we have a monastery. It's called El Muharrak Monastery. And the Holy Family visited actually El Muharrak during their stay in Egypt. They visited this area and stayed there. And now there is a monastery. So this actually word, in that day there will be an altar to the Lord in the midst of the land of Egypt, was fulfilled actually literally, because El Muharrak Monastery is exactly in the middle between east and west and north and south in the middle of Egypt. And these pictures from El Muharrak Monastery. So the first contribution is monasticism. Second contribution is teaching and keeping dogma. I'm sure any seminarian or any believer have read the book Incarnation of the Logos, written by Saint Athanasius. Because in order to understand the economy of salvation, this book is very, very important book and written by Saint Athanasius. Saint Athanasius actually is Egyptian, and he is Pope number 20. If Saint Mark number 1, Saint Athanasius is number 20. And this is actually the picture of Saint Athanasius. Saint Athanasius, during the Council of Nicaea, he was still a deacon, not a priest even. And he defended the divinity of Christ against Arius. Arius, who said that Christ is not God. And he is considered the hero of the Council of Nicaea. And the people around him in the icon represent the 318 bishops who gathered in the Council of Nicaea. Also, the first theological school was the School of Alexandria, established by St. Mark. And the dean of this school used to be ordained as the Pope of Alexandria. And this shows you how the Coptic Church valued the importance of faith and teaching and theology. So many great theologians graduated from this school. And in the first three ecumenical councils, the Coptic Church leaders were the pioneers. St. Athanasius in the Council of Nicaea, Pope Timothy the 22nd in the Council of Constantinople, and St. Cyril the Great in the Council of Ephesus. And Coptic Orthodox Church defended the faith against all heresies and kept it unchanged. The creed, we believe in one God, that we recited together actually tonight, is written by St. Athanasius in the Council of Nicaea. And now it's adopted by the Council of Nicaea, and all the churches now, traditional churches, apostolic churches, are reciting it. And as I told you, St. Athanasius is known by his very well-known book, The Incarnation of the Logos. The third contribution to Christianity is martyrdom. And Coptic Church is the church of martyrs. Of course, during the time of Diocletian, hundreds of thousands of martyrs from all ages were killed in Egypt, whether individually or in groups, whether children like St. Kyriakos or St. Rebecca and her children as a family, or in youth like St. Abanoub, or in groups like with St. Abanoub, 8,000 persons were martyred in Samanud. And when I speak about martyrdom, it did not end by 4th century. I'm sure all of you heard about the 20 martyrs of Libya. That is their icon in the background. And this was a few years ago. And we saw their courage, how actually they did not deny their faith and accepted to be killed and to shed their blood for the love of Christ. So the Coptic Church is a church of martyrdom. Also, the Coptic Church is a church of evangelism. It took the great commission of our Lord Jesus Christ, go and preach the gospel to the whole world very seriously. So Egypt reached Christianity, for example, in Europe. If you visit Switzerland, who is actually patron saint of Switzerland? Saint Verena and Saint Maurice. And Saint Maurice and Saint Verena are Egyptian from Upper Egypt. They went there to support Switzerland in a war. So the emperor asked them to deny Christ. And the Tibian legion, they refused. So he wanted to scare them. And he put them in order, and he killed, for example, number 10. And then he counted 9 and killed number 20. To scare them, they were 6,000. Not one single person from this legend actually denied the Lord Jesus Christ. And all of them died for their love of Christ. And the captain of this legend, his name, Saint Maurice. And there was a nurse helping them, and this nurse, Saint Verena. And after actually the martyrdom of all these soldiers, Saint Verena continued in Switzerland. And because she helped the poor, helped the sick, many people actually believed in Christ because of her. And you can find in her hand, right hand, pitcher of water, and left hand, like comb, because she was a nurse and helped actually the people in Switzerland to know about personal hygiene. And she, as a nurse, she told them how to take care not only of their of their physical body, but also of their spiritual body. Also, seven monks from Egypt preached Christianity in Ireland. Most of the African churches are considered daughter churches of the Coptic Orthodox Church, like Ethiopia and Eritrea. They are daughter churches of the Coptic Orthodox Church. And Coptic church fathers contributed a lot to the doctrine and spiritual writing. So these are the four main contributions of Coptic church to Christianity in the world. Monasticism, martyrdom, doctrine and teaching, and evangelism. Again, I thank all of you for coming tonight and giving me this opportunity to speak about our beloved Coptic Orthodox Church. And thank you, Father Thomas, for accepting all of us and inviting us to share this night with you. We ask your prayer for us, and we pray for you. And through the spirit of prayer, we ask God that one day all the Christians in the whole world will return back and become one body and one for one for our one Christ. As the Lord said in John chapter 17, I pray that all of them be one. Glory be to God forever and ever. Amen. Yes. Yes.
Father, thank you so much, okay, for coming to Hong Kong to share with us, okay, about the Egyptian Orthodox history. And I just want to know, you know, in your presentation, okay, there's five different, one, two, three, four, five different Orthodox organization. And each one of them has their own organization, maybe philosophy of Christianity. Now, how likely that there will be a unification of all those five churches?
How?
Again.
Unification. Unification?
Yeah, unity. That's right.
Yes. Actually, thank God, as I mentioned, we started a dialogue, and this dialogue started back in the 60s, but continued. And this dialogue not only between Orthodox churches, but also Orthodox and Catholic, and also some denominations from the Protestant church. So the unification, to be one, we need actually to have one faith first. Because the split was because of the faith, of the doctrines. And if we go back to the roots, if we go back to before 451 and see how our fathers understood the scripture, what was the faith of our fathers before 451, I think it will be easy to be unified together. But there are other factors actually playing and influencing every church. And so we have bias as human beings, we are biased to who we are. But if we became very objective and we studied the faith and we go back to the roots, as I said, before 451, and see how the church understood the salvation, how the church understood the nature of Christ, then unification and unity between all different denominations will be possible, because all of us who cannot be right in the same time.
Another question? Okay, please.
Okay, thank you, Father. May I ask you how many Christians in Egypt now? And also, I know both Christian and Muslim are two big religions in Egypt, right? And how the shares, is it 50 or 50, or Christian and Muslim is more? And how do you, is it the same Bible they're using for different Christian church?
So you're asking about the number of Christians in Egypt?
Yeah.
And
is it the Bible are the same for different Christian church? They're using the same Bible?
Different,
same
Bible, yes.
Yeah,
okay. The Copts, the Christian in Egypt, are almost 20%. So now Egypt are between 110 and 120 million. So I can say we are above 20 million. So maybe 22, something like this, 22 million Christian in Egypt. All of us, we use the same Bible. But we, the Orthodox Church and the Catholic Church also, we believe in the deuterocanonical books, like the Book of Tobit, Sirach, the Wisdom of Solomon. The Protestant, they don't actually accept these books as canonical books. But all the Orthodox and the Catholic accept. So our Bible actually is not like the Protestant, but has the books that were eliminated by the Protestant, called the deuterocanonical books, like Tobit, Sirach, Wisdom of Solomon, Judith, First Maccabees, Second Maccabees. That's the Bible we are using it. Most of the Christians in Egypt are Orthodox. We have some Catholic, we have some Episcopal, we have some Protestant from different background. But the most of the Christians in Egypt are Coptic Orthodox. Did they answer all your questions?
Yeah, okay. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, it is, the majority of the Egyptians are Muslims. And it is prohibited to evangelize in Egypt. You cannot just convert Muslims to Christianity. You cannot. It's prohibited.
Okay. Thank you so much for your presentation. I was especially pleased and surprised to learn about the union, the statement of faith between the Eastern Orthodox and the Coptic. And the language on your slide was about a union without mingling, confusion, or alteration. And if I remember my theology, that's almost the same language as Chalcedon.
Yes.
So I'm wondering, what is the difference now?
Okay.
In your mind?
This dialogue actually happened between the representatives of the churches. When they took the agreed statement to their churches, in the Oriental family, the six churches accepted the agreed statement. The Coptic Orthodox Church accepted the agreed statement in the Holy Synod in year 1991. But in the Eastern Orthodox churches, not all the churches, they accepted the agreed statement. For example, the Russians said, we came after communism and we need more time to study theology to say this agreed statement. Also, there is one difference happened, is one in two nature or one from two natures. You know? So the Eastern insist one in two natures. But we say one from two natures. And there are big difference between one from two or one in two, in two natures. So that's why after we were ready, the Coptic Orthodox Church, we were ready to be in full communion, But because 16 churches from the eastern side, not all of them accepted the agreed statement. That's why until now, we are not in communion back with the eastern. But there are, we start to take some steps. For example, now if a person joined us from the eastern, we don't baptize him. So we accepted their baptism as a step toward full communion.
So thank you, Father, and it's very insightful to hear what you said. Moreover, I want to ask some questions in my mind. First of all, does the Coptic Church in Egypt recognize the apostolic successions of other seats of, for example, maybe the Constantinople and the Rome, do they still accept that the Eastern Orthodox or the Roman Catholic Church have their valid apostolic succession line and hence confers valid sacraments? And my second question is, how does the Coptic Church think of some rituals or practices from other Christian denominations, such as the Holy Rosary and such? Yeah.
When His Holiness Pope Shenouda, with the blessed memory, visited Rome, Pope Paul VI in the 70s, they published together a statement in which actually they said both Coptic Orthodox Church and the Roman Catholic Church kept the apostolic tradition and kept the sacraments of the church. So they focused, definitely there are differences, but in this statement they focused on the similarities. We know that the Church of Rome was founded by the apostles and the Coptic Church founded by St. Mark. Regarding the practices, each church actually is unique in their own practices. That is the work of the Holy Spirit in this culture. So even within the Oriental family, many practices in the Coptic Church are different than the Ethiopian, different than the Armenian, different than the Indian, because the work of the Holy Spirit in the Egyptian culture has its uniqueness. The work of the Holy Spirit in Ethiopia has its uniqueness. In the same way, the work of the Holy Spirit in the Church of Rome has also its uniqueness. So we don't use the rosary, although we have in our prayers many veneration to Saint Mary, the Mother of God. We have doxologies, veneration to Saint Mary, in which we say, "Hail to you, full of glory." So it's very similar to some prayers of the rosary. Yes, there are differences, like the Immaculate Conception. We don't accept the Immaculate Conception. But there are also similarities in venerating St. Mary, the Mother of God.
A question from Sister.
Thank you for your presentation. Two things. One is my question about the liturgy. Are we celebrating the same Easter time? That's one. The second is about the practice of priestly celibacy. I think you have
practice
a
of?
The celibacy, the
celibacy.
Married priest.
Ah.
I think we have a difference also there.
Okay.
Maybe for my curiosity, if you can answer. Thank you.
In the Coptic Church, we have three liturgies. Two from Byzantine background and one actually Coptic background. The Coptic background is written by St. Mark of Alexandria, St. Mark, and was edited and updated by St. Cyril of Alexandria. And now it is called St. Cyril liturgy, the Cyrillian liturgy. But we use also two other liturgies from Byzantine background, St. Basil liturgy and St. Gregory liturgy. So these are the three liturgies we use in the Coptic Church: St. Basil, St. Gregory, and St. Cyril liturgy. Regarding celibacy, in the Coptic Church, only the monks and the bishops are celibate. But the priests are chosen from married people. But there are monk priests. So if a monk is ordained a priest, then he is a celibate. But most of the priests serving the parishes are married priests, not like the Catholic Church.
Oh, by the way, it's around 9. May I know how many questions people like to ask? Put up your hands.
Again?
One.
Also about the date of Easter.
One and a half.
Date of Easter, okay.
Two. Are you going to ask? That means after 3 questions, we will pray together. Is it okay? Okay, the first one you ask. Please.
Your Honor, Patriarch or Bishop Joseph or Yosef.
Yosef, yes.
Yeah.
This is Joseph.
In order to ask the third last question tonight for the Q&A session. Well, it's a question from the Anglican world.
Please.
My... Okay, yeah. Closer. All right. My question is basically about the Christological inquiries of the meaphysis stance as opposed to the diaphysis stance. Just want to challenge a little bit further to wrestle for your in-depth exposition on these issues. So in my understanding of your lecture earlier on, or your speech.
What? We cannot hear your question.
Oh, okay.
We cannot take part in your question.
So Your Honor, you made it very clear on the differentiation between the Eastern and Western Chalcedonian churches by the split of the Greek Schism 1054. So that's the Chalcedonian Filioque dispute, basically or literally from
the procession
and the sun. That's what it means in Greek.
Exactly.
Filioque. And the sun and. So basically, the Eastern Chalcedonian Church understands that the Ruach Elohim or the Sanctus Spiritus is from the Father alone.
Alone, yes.
And the Western, the Father and the Son.
Yeah.
And your stance, in my understanding, if I didn't get it wrong, is meaphysis. So there's neither the Eastern Chalcedonian stance or the Western. So could you clarify further bit on the meaphysis?
There are two points.
One from two.
Yes. Meaphysis, one from two.
Meaphysis, one from two.
Yeah. Diophysis, two natures.
Two natures.
So the Eastern Orthodox and the Roman Catholic believe in diophysis, two natures.
Two natures, yes.
We believe in meaphysis, one nature from two.
What's the difference?
Okay. The Catholic Church and the Eastern, two natures are like this. So two natures united in one person.
Yes.
Okay? But two distinct natures, but united in one person.
Mm-hmm.
St. Cyril said no. This union is like when actually you heat the iron in fire. You cannot see the iron and the fire like this, you know? So the two natures are united together, but in a mystical way, without mingling, without confusion, and without alteration.
I think that's the common ground of Nicaea 325 and Constantinople 381 and maybe 431 and first Ephesus. You have a common ground there.
That's why in the agreed statement, we said, let us actually forget about what happened in Chalcedon.
Mm-hmm.
Express your faith and let us try to reach a joint statement. And both churches, both families agreed to say, we believe that Jesus Christ is perfectly divine, perfect human,
yes.
These two natures are united together, and we excommunicate the heresy of Nestorius and heresy of Eutychus. And this was the agreement between the theologians of both families. But when they took the statement to the Holy Synod to approve it, unfortunately, in the Eastern side, most of them, they rejected the agreed statement. That's why we are not in communion right now.
No, thank you for your explanation.
Thank you.
Your Honor.
Thank you.
Okay, the second question. Oh, Egal, please.
Father, hello. Yes. May I know nowadays how the corporate church doing about the gospel sharing, and what is the main challenge about the sharing gospel?
Sharing gospel, you mean to preach other, to
preaching, share? Yeah, yeah, and do the evangelical work. Yeah.
Actually, as I said, it is part of the Great Commission. The Lord gave us the gospel not to keep it for ourselves, but the Lord gave us the gospel to share it with others. He said, go and preach the gospel to all the world, not to one nation. And in heaven, actually, as you read in the book of Revelation, from every tribe, from every tongue, from every nation. So heaven actually is multicultural. Heaven is, so the church should be multicultural. Any church actually, because the church is the icon of heaven. So if we start preaching and sharing the gospel with everyone around us, then the churches will have from every tribe, every tongue, every language, because all of us will become to be members in one body, the body of Christ. So it's our responsibility as Christian. The Lord told, you will be witnesses of me in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and to the end of the whole earth.
Okay, the third question and the last one.
Thank you. I'm very impressed about the silent drummer. So is many youth or the teenagers involved in the church nowadays in Egypt, so that you have this very impressive and very famous, like the symbolic and very interactive. So I think we can learn a lot from you. And also in Hong Kong, the church involved in many services like education, hospital, and community service. How about this nowadays in Egypt? Is there any challenges like evangelization in the Sunday school, in the school? We are facing challenges now. Yes, thank you.
Definitely, Yani, as it was social bees, there is challenges in every time. But in our churches, we try to have a very strong Sunday school curriculum, because when you teach the children from very, very young age, when they grow, actually, they will be steadfast in their faith. The same for the family. The Coptic Church cares for the family. And we have like a premarital program to prepare the couple for marriage. And if you have a strong family, you will have also strong children. And the children are the future of the church. One of the challenges that face all of us in the whole world is the media, and how the media now became very anti-Christian. And even the cartoons, the games, the everything our children are watching. That's why parents should be very careful in how to use the media and how to expose our children to the media if we want to keep them in the right faith, not to be drifted and not to be influenced by the anti-Christianity spirit that's actually, unfortunately, growing in the whole world.
Hey, thank you again.
Thank you, Father. Thank
you. Your Eminence. Some announcement before the closing prayer.
Yes.
Some announcement before the closing prayer.
Yeah. Just one minute, because the sister...
You got one email, one.
If you give me one minute.
Okay, yes, indeed. Yes.
Regarding, they asked about the date of Easter. You know, we in the Council of Nicaea, they decided that actually the day of Easter, the day of resurrection, should be on Sunday and not celebrated with the Passover of the Jews. That's why we follow the calendar of the Orthodox Easter. Pope Gregory, who actually made the Gregorian calendar, he changed the day of Easter to be after the spring equinox, regardless whether it comes with the Passover or not. But the Orthodox churches, actually, they did not follow this. And until now, we follow the old calculation for the Easter, to be on Sunday and not to come with the Passover of the Jews. And also in our Christmas, we celebrate it in January 7th, following the old Julian calendar, not the Gregorian calendar. So that is, there are articles explaining in details how we calculate the day of Easter and how they calculate the day of Christmas. Actually, we can ask Father Dawood here to send it to you if you are interested to read more about how the Coptic Church, the date of Christmas and the date of Easter. Thanks so much.
Thank you again. He said about the date of Easter. Yeah, next year. Next year, what day will be the Easter? The 20th of April, am I right? Next year, 2025. 2025. Yeah, right? 2025 is the 20th of April, yeah. Which is the same day with the Orthodox.
Yes.
The same day with the Orthodox.
We celebrated together, I think, once
yes.
every 4 years.
And also remember, yeah. 350, the Council of Nicaea. We settled down about how to count it, and actually, it's Alexandria who count the days and inform Rome to announce to all churches. Who is the famous guy who announced that? Laura Anastasius. Yeah, it's a famous thing from Alexandria. And so you ask the question, next year you ask again. And you know why. Yeah. Okay, thank you again.
Thank you, Your Eminence. Thank you.
Some announcement. Father David, help me. First of all, tomorrow morning, they have the celebration of baptism. Tomorrow, yes, Monday morning. Baptism, Miron, and the Eucharist, the Divine Liturgy. What time, please? Another microphone, please. We have a lot of microphone. So to easily evangelize the whole Hong Kong people.
God willing, tomorrow will start at 8.
8?
8 a.m. for consecration of the water.
Consecration of the water. Okay. How long will it take?
Around 1 hour.
1 hour. To bless the water and then?
Yeah. And then the baptism.
And the baptism.
After that, the Holy Miron.
And the Holy Miron.
And the end will start the Divine Liturgy.
The Divine Liturgy.
Yes.
That means if you have interest, go around 8 yes. and then continue and you will see everything.
Yes.
Is that okay? And then tomorrow evening
yes.
you have another sacrament.
Yes.
The sacrament of matrimony.
Yes.
Start at what time?
We'll start at 6 p.m. 6 p.m.
6 p.m.
Yes.
Don't ask how long it will be, huh? Because forever and ever marriage, it must be forever and ever.
Yes, perfect.
And then we have a talk. At what time?
We start at 7.
7. Am I right? 7. I'm having one of Kim Chaya. 7:30, Father.
Yes, sir.
7:30.
7:30.
7:30 at end of around 9. And then the most important, Saturday morning.
Yes.
The consecration of the church.
God willing.
What time will it begin?
So we have to all ready before the bishop arrived. So
yeah.
We have to be ready in the church maximum at 8 p.m. 8 a.m.
8 a.m. starts. Then you go. And then you have the consecration of the church.
Yeah, consecrations after the Divine Liturgy. And
yeah, Divine Liturgy, the Eucharist.
Yeah, during Divine Liturgy, we'll start ordination deacons.
Yes, and in around 1.
Yes.
Am I right?
Yes.
Okay, then we have a talk at what time? Tell me, Laura. Get the team away.
Say
team, am I? At 4?
Yeah, 4.
Laura, say job.
From 4 to 6.
Yeah, 4.
From 4 to 6.
And end around?
6.
Okay. And so, no, I find it now.
Yes.
It's 4:30 to 6. 4:30 and 6, okay? come earlier and pray together. Is that okay? Remember.
Thank you.
No, I'm really trying to proclaim the good news now, boys. 还有, may I say something in Chinese? 还有刚才说的那些一鸡两尾，一鸭两色，那些东西，还有这些分裂，又回来，我写一篇文，在神师也有，我印在出来了，放在外面，自己搞定，叫做合一，还有，又worship了给你们了，版权所有，多些传开去，No matter how, Father, it's a great day because we share together the Christianity, the salvation that God grants us all through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ.
I want to say something.
Yes, please.
We are so happy to come with you. We are in Hong Kong, as I explained to you before. Coptic Church in Hong Kong since 2004 till now. Now we are so happy with our bishops in Hong Kong to consecration the church and our place. So I hope we can cooperate together. So anytime we are willing to come, we can also invite our bishops anytime to come to can share the good news together and to can talk together anytime.
Yeah.
We are flexible. We can trying to manage our time according to your needs.
Sometimes I think of making some visitation and even we can do some charity work together. And even we can celebrate the Christmas according to your tradition to be the Epiphany, am I right?
Yes.
So actually Epiphany comes from the Coptic Church. It starts from the river Nile, am I right? And so how happy we are, we can share together the same feast of Epiphany.
You are most welcome.
Yeah, and so many, many chances we can cooperate.
I hope.
Since you are here.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father.
I say something in Chinese again. Our Christian church has 24 churches. The Roman church is only one. 雖然霸道一點很多，但是我們都欣賞對方。另外呢，就是我們一會會跟他們一起念順經，大家都知道這個順經，基本上就是我們主日念的順經，不過念到呢，是聖父、聖子、共法、聖神，那我們是會念聖父、聖神、又父所發，這個完全沒問題的。 因為點解呢？約望保祿二世已經有一個好明文嘅講法㗎啦，喺個傾偈嘅過程啦。咁同埋喺羅馬教會講到明咧，如果我哋同 Orthodox 或者係念希臘文咧，係唔準加俾啲惡鬼。咁你係明白，所以我哋可以一齊念嘅。咁另外咧，仲有就係咧 ，Father may I ask after the creed, we may say that our Father together.
Yes, together.
Because the same prayer that the Lord teaches us, and so we pray together with the Lord's prayer. Oh, before we say the last prayer, I think we need to give you something to remember us.
Thank you. What is it?
His Eminence. This is the icon of the Chinese Madonna. The Chinese Madonna is called Our Lady of Shaoshan. And so you can remember the Chinese church whenever and wherever.
Thank you so much.
With the prayer. the Chinese Madonna. Our Lady of Shaoshan. Thank you so much for your coming.
Thank you, Father Thomas. Our bishops will give to each one some small gift for each one to remember us. And also, each one have the QR invitations in the back of the verse, what the bishops will give you, so you can follow us anytime. You are most welcome. Thank you.
Very good. Thank you. Your Eminence, we may say the creed together, and then we say the Lord's Prayer together. And please bless us afterwards, after the prayer. 我们起来,我们一起念信经,他会带我们念的,然后呢,他会念天主经。
We believe in one God, God the Father, the Almighty, who created heaven and earth, and all things seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of the Father before all ages, light of light, true God, begotten, not created, of one essence with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and of the Virgin Mary and became man. And he was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate, suffered and was buried, and on the third day, according to the scriptures, and ascended into the heavens and sat at the right hand of his Father. He is coming again in his glory to judge the living and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. Yes, we believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the life giver, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who spoke in the prophets, and in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, we confess one baptism for the remission of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the coming age. Amen. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the coming age. Amen. We thank you, Lord, for this meeting. We ask to bless all of us with your heavenly blessings. Give us to be steadfast in our faith and to proclaim the good news with everyone around us. Hear us through the intercession of Saint Mary, Mother of God, Saint Thomas, Saint Mark, and all the saints have pleased you since the beginning. Hear us, O Lord, when we pray thankfully. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one, in Christ Jesus our Lord. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The love of God the Father, the grace of his only begotten Son, our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, and the communion and the gift of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Go in peace. The peace of our Lord be with you all.
Excuse me, we can be close to each other, and our bishop will stay in the middle, and we can take photo for all of you.
Oh, 知唔知講咩？我哋拍埋啲一齊影相啊！ 邊個幫我哋啊？ 喺樓上影啊！ 好啊！ 你喺樓上影落嚟啊！ There's a place for taking photo, you can see.
Outside?
No, no, no. From the clock. You just stand here. Bishop, you just come over here. Yeah, you can see. 各位，你哋望住樓上嗰個窿啊！ 誒，嗰個僆仔伸個頭出嚟嗰度啊！ 見唔見到？ 你行埋中間啦。 係啊。 This is the place we want to take a picture. Okay. 好啦，自己拎个头出嚟啦。Yeah, just stretch your neck. Yeah, the bishop. Stand up. A, B, C, D. E. Again. A, B, C, D. E.
You can see the cockpit now.
Yeah, see
in
cockpit.
Emmanuel. One more time. Emmanuel.
Thank you again.
Our bishop will stand outside in the front of the door. Each one, he can go outside, he can take the gift from our bishop. Thank you for all.
That's the one outside.